Namaste. Welcome to this conversation in Atharva Forum. And today I have my pleasure to converse with a world-renowned Sanskritist, Professor Nagaraja. Welcome, Professor Nagaraja.
Thank you.
Today we will be talking specifically about Meghadutam by Kalidasa. So let me begin by this very general question. Why is Kalidasa considered as one of the greatest poets? Maybe you can start with that.
Well, in Sanskrit literature, the first poet, Adi Kavi, is called Valmiki. And the next most illustrious author is Vyasa. And after these two, the third name that comes to mind is Kalidasa. Those two greats, Valmiki and Vyasa, were considered as rishis. But in the world of ordinary life, when we are talking about the mortals, about human beings, the person that comes right away into the mind is Kalidasa, because he represents the whole country. He is a pan-Indian poet. He knew the country of India, its history, its geography, its specialties very well. And he was also such a sensitive person. He knew the throbbings of the hearts of all the people. And therefore, and also because he had such a great mastery of the language of Sanskrit, and therefore, he is unique. There are other poets who are very good in the language, but their ability to touch the hearts of the readers was not so good. And there were poets who gave the highest importance to emotion, but their mastery on the language was not so good. In all aspects, Kalidasa excels others, and therefore he is considered as Kavikula Guru. Kavikula Guru Kalidasu Vilasa. For the goddess of muse, Kalidasa is like her Vilasa, her great expressions of love. And therefore, Kalidasa occupies a very high place in the history of Sanskrit literature.
Thank you, sir. That's a very wonderful opening remark. And as you rightly said, he is a pan-Indic poet, having both a very deep knowledge about the history as well as geography of India. And today's topic, as we have taken, it's to do with the geography of India as espoused in his particular work called Meghadutam.
So, yes, I have to make one remark. In his Raghuvamsha, in his epic poem called Raghuvamsha, he has given a very wonderful description of the whole of India. Because there he describes the expedition of Emperor Raghu in all the four directions. And therefore, there we have the description of India from Assam to Gujarat, from Kanyakumari to the Himalayas. The whole of India is described there. In the Meghadutam, it is only a part. In the Meghaduta, he has the theme of a yaksha who is trying to send a message to his beloved who lived in the city of Alaka. This yaksha was cursed by his master Kubera, and therefore he had to be separated from his beloved, and he came to a place called the Ramagiri. In the very first opening verse of the Meghaduta, the poet says, Kaschit Kanta Viraha Guruna Swadhikarat Pramattaha Shapen Astangamita Mahima Varsha Bhogyena Bhartu Yakshas Chakre Janakatanayas Nana Punyodakeshu Snigdha Chaya Tarushu Vasatim Ramagiri Ashrameshu. There, Ramagiri Ashrameshu. That Ramagiri is now identified as a place called Ramtek near Nagpur in the state of Maharashtra. And that place, in that place, actually now a Sanskrit university has been established under the name Kavikula Guru Kalidasa Sanskrita University. And therefore, from that place to Alaka, which is in the vicinity of the Himalayas, to that city, he is sending a message through a cloud. And in the Meghaduta, there are two parts. In the first part, the poet describes the route to be taken by the cloud. And then in the second part, he actually gives the message which had to be conveyed by the cloud to the Yaksha's beloved. And therefore, in the first half of the Meghaduta, we have a description of the country starting from Ramagiri, that is Ramtek near Nagpur, to up to the Alaka. And therefore, here we have the description of some important places in North India, not the whole of India. If we have to see the width and breadth of Kalidasa's knowledge about the geography of India, then we have to take the Raghuvamsa. But today we are limiting ourselves to the description of India given by Kalidasa in the first part of the Meghaduta.
And in fact, I would say you have also laid a preamble for another conversation on Raghuvamsa, and that will happen on perhaps some other day. So let me ask a related question, that is that the Indian classical literature, be it the Sangam literature of Tamil or the Sanskrit literature, they share an extensive geographical motif. So in that sense, does Kalidasa and his allusion to geography, be it in Raghuvamsa or be it in Meghaduta, is it unique of Kalidasa, or are there other poets also who allude to the geography to the extent which Kalidasa alludes to?
Well, in the great works of Valmiki, in the Ramayana and of Vyasa, the Mahabharata, we have the descriptions of various places in India. It is already there. And the Puranas give extensive descriptions of particular areas, because the Puranas want to describe the holy places where pilgrims would congregate. And so in such places, these descriptions are there. But Kalidasa is special because when he describes a place, he gives it a personal touch. He has such an affinity with those places that his genius, poetic genius, flowers there. And therefore, those places, when we actually visit them, they might appear as ordinary, But when Kalidasa describes them, they appear to be divine and heavenly. That was the new touch given by the poet, and therefore his descriptions are more important. I don't say that there is no such description in other works. There is Tirtha Prabandha, which describes all the centers of pilgrimage all over India, and such works are there. But Kalidasa, when he describes some place, it may be a river, it may be a hill, it may be a city, it becomes very special, so attractive, so superlative, all these things happen.
No wonder Kalidasa is also described, his work is described as Drakshapata, because it is in a very lucid way he describes these things. Moving ahead, as you already mentioned in your opening remark, I'm just extending this question from there. Can you please give us an overview of the cultural aspects of the cities and other geographies that Kalidasa gives in the first act of Meghadutam, starting from Ramagiri or Ramtek to the Puranic city of Alaka in the Himalaya?
Yeah, for that, what we have to understand is the world in which Kalidasa existed. He did not live in the 20th century or 21st century. Frankly speaking, we do not know in which century exactly he lived, because there is lack of evidence. In his works, only his name is seen and nothing about his personal life. We do not know who his parents were, who his patron was. Of course, there are allusions to such patrons. In one work called Jyotirvidabharana, Vikramaditya is said to have been the patron of Kalidasa. Dhanvantari Kshapana Kamara Simha Shanku Vetala Bhatta Ghatakarpara Kalidasa Nripate Sabhayam Ratnani Vai Vararuchir Navam. In Vikrama's big court, there were 9 gems, among whom Kalidasa was the most important. That is what is said there. But it cannot be a historical truth, because all these persons mentioned there were not at the same time. Varahamihira was in a different century, and therefore we cannot take it as historical truth. And there are also books which say that King Bhoja of Dhara in Malwa country, he was the patron of Kalidasa. On the friendship of Kalidasa and Bhoja, many films have been made, many dramas are there, but all those things are unhistorical. We definitely know that Bhoja lived in the 11th century AD, but Kalidasa lived many centuries ago, and therefore there is no possibility of their meeting or anything. However, one thing is that Kalidasa in all his works mentions only one historical person, and that historical person was Agnimitra Shringa. After the fall of the Mauryan Empire, the Shunga dynasty came into power in North India. And there, Pushyamitra Shringa, he lived in the 2nd century, we know that definitely. He was a historical person, and so we know that. And then his son Agnimitra ruled the Vidarbha. And therefore, Kalidasa has written a drama called Malavika Agnimitra, making this Agnimitra the hero. He must have lived after Agnimitra. There is no doubt about it. And so it is possible that Kalidasa lived in the first century before Christ. That is possible. But most Western scholars are of the opinion that Kalidasa lived in the Gupta age, probably after Samudragupta, who took an expedition all over India and comparing that expedition with Raghu's expedition much, much earlier before Rama, Kalidasa has described India. And therefore, we must understand that by the mention of various cities in the works of Kalidasa, he should have lived in a particular cultural situation. He mentions Vidisha, he mentions Ujjain, he mentions Dasharana, he mentions Dashapura. All these cities are mentioned. And even when he mentions some things, we cannot say that he actually could have seen those things, because he mentions the river Saraswati in the Meghadutta. He gives a beautiful description of the river Saraswati. But if Kalidasa had lived in the Gupta era, in the 4th or 5th century AD, by that time, this Saraswati had disappeared. The Saraswati was the mightiest river at the time of the Rig Veda. Probably you might have known that even the Ganga and Yamuna are only mentioned in one or two mantras of the Rig Veda. In the Nadi Sukta, Imam Me Gange, Yamune, Saraswati, Shutudri, many rivers are mentioned. There Ganga is mentioned, but not a big description of the Ganga. But for Saraswati, in the Rig Veda, we have an exclusive, complete Sukta. Ambitame, Naditame, like that, Saraswati is addressed. At that time, at the time of the Rig Veda, the Saraswati was the mightiest river. But on account of the climatic change, or probably on account of the change of the course of the river, has dried up in its natural course. Nowadays, just the satellites have been able to trace the course of the river Saraswati. And so, we have to fix our mind in a certain period of history, and with that, we have to understand Kalidasa's descriptions. And if you want me to talk about Kalidasa's date correctly, as I said, we do not have any strong evidence, but we definitely know that he was before the 7th century AD. Because, see, this might be interesting to you. In the whole of India, even though Kalidasa describes various places like the Ujjain in high terms, it is only in Karnataka that the earliest stone inscription that refers to Kalidasa is found. It is only in Karnataka. We have a place called Aihole. In that place, we have Ravikirti's inscription. And in that, Ravikirti refers to two Sanskrit poets, Kalidasa and Bharavi. Yena yojina veshma sthiramartha vidhau vivekina jina veshma sa vijayatam Ravikirtihi kavitashrita Kalidasa Bharavi kirtihi. Like that, he refers to Kalidasa. And that inscription is dated 634 AD. That we know definitely. And in the first half of the 7th century, from 608 to 648, Harshavardhana ruled North India. And in his court, there was the great poet Bana, who has written the story of Harsha, Harsha Charita, and also the Kadambari. And in the Harsha Charita, in the introductory verses, Bana refers to Kalidasa. Nirgatasu navakasya kalidasasya suktishu pritir madhura sardrasu manjarishviva jayate. Like that he refers to. And therefore, the only thing that we definitely know is Kalidasa lived before the 7th century, and he was definitely after the 2nd century BC when Agnimitra lived. About everything else is only intellectual guess, intelligent guess. That is what we can do. And so, when Kalidasa describes something, we have to imagine the situation in which he was placed and what type of poetry was flowing in those days. And according to that, we have to understand him.
That's a beautiful insight, sir. And I'm just tempted to ask, in that case, in that whole bracket of intellectual guess, there is another school of thought which is also said that there is not just one Kalidasa in India's history, there are multiple Kalidasas. So can you give a brief comment on that before I proceed on to the next question?
Well, as you know, it is the tradition that when someone becomes very great, later people are called by that name to raise their level. So there are many Abhinava Kalidasas. One Akbariya Kalidasa, at the time of Akbar, there was a poet, he is also called Kalidasa. And even in the 19th century, in Karnataka, there was one Basavappa Shastri, who was a very great Kannada poet. He translated Kalidasa's Abhijnana Shakuntala drama into Kannada, and therefore he was given the title Abhinava Kalidasa. And thus, in India's history, there are many people who have been called Navakalidasa, Abhinava Kalidasa, etc. That is a different thing. But we are referring to one ancient poet who wrote three dramas, Madhavikagnimitra, Vikramurvashiya, and Abhijnana Shakuntala, who wrote two epic poems, Kumara Sambhava and Raghuvamsha, and two shorter works, one is the Meghaduta, another one is the Ruta Samhara. See, about him we are talking. About others, they might have claimed that they are Kalidasa, or the title might have been given to many people.
I was inspired to ask that question because we have most of our ancient intellectuals, we have a problem in dating them. Yes. So is it that in the history we had multiple Kalidasas, that we have a range from all the way from 2nd century BCE to 7th century CE? So that was the inspiration for me to ask, were there multiple Kalidasas? So anyway, moving ahead, as you said in one of your previous comment, that when Kalidasa described the city, he was using the maximum superlatives. I mean, for us it may look very ordinary. And again, in his cultural milieu, from his point of view, as he saw those cities, can you give us a brief description of them as he has moved from Ramtek, say, through Dashapura to the Himalayan city of Malacca? Briefly about them, from as Kalidasa have viewed it and as you have enjoyed it. Let's all hear it from you now.
Kalidasa was a very sensitive person. He knew many villages, many cities, the rivers, hills, mountains, everything he knew. He was also very much close to the real life of the people. He knows their specialities, from city to city, and this special quality of Sanskrit poetry is achetane chetanatva aropa. Even in non-living beings, the poet thinks that they are able to understand these things and thinking them as a friend, as a close companion, he addresses them and gives descriptions. And so here, what happens is, he thinks about the cloud as a real person. Of course, the poet gives the explanation, dhumaj jyotis salilam marutam sannipata hakva megha, where is the cloud, which is just a collection of smoke, water vapor, jyoti, all these things. And how can it understand? How can it take a message and convey it to the beloved of the Yaksha? But he says, kamartha hi prakriti kripanaha chetana chetaneshu. Between chetana and achetana, a person is forlorn on account of the separation of his beloved, is not able to see the difference. And thus, this message can be conveyed by the cloud. And when he talks about the cloud, even when leaving this Ramagiri, he says, apruchaswa priya sakhamamum tungamalingya shailam. This is your sakha. This hill is your sakha. And apruchaswa, say goodbye to him. Say adieu to him. That is how he is sending the cloud from that place to the next place. And then, whenever there is a river, he does not think that it is just an amount of water. He thinks that it is a lovely woman that is flowing there. And therefore, when the cloud is going there, what are her reactions in the river? If there are lotus flowers, the poet thinks that they are her eyes and that she is looking at this cloud as her lover. How the cloud should collect the water from different rivers, and how he should shower it on different hills which might have been troubled by the wildfire. All these things come to his mind. And therefore, from Ramagiri, while he is going, he sees a river called Nirvindhya, and he also sees another hill called Amrakuta. Amra in Sanskrit means mango. And therefore, there were so many mango trees on that hill. And therefore, how that river is looking, all these things he describes. And then, his favorite river is Rewa. Rewa is another name for Narmada. Rewa, Narmada. These two are synonyms, it is said. And so he sees that river, and Vindhyapade Vishirinam, that which is flowing under the foothills of the Vindhya. He is describing it wonderfully. And how that water should be collected there, all these things are described. And then when the cloud is moving forward, it sees a country called Dasharana. Dasharana, what could be the meaning? That is a very difficult question, because according to Panini, by the combination of the words Dasha and Rina, we get the form Dasharana, according to Panini's grammar. But the Riya Dasha, then it means a place which had 10 loans, which had taken 10 loans. But the real meaning could be, in Sanskrit, arinas means water. You know the word Arinava, Arinab Goswami. Arinava means the sea, the ocean. There it is because waters are collected there. And then Dasharana could be a place where there were 10 streams flowing. So, Katipaya Dinasthaya Hamsa Dasharanaha. That is how he says. There, while you are going, many hamsas, many geese or many swans are following you, and the swans wish to stay for some time in Dasharana. Katipaya Dinasthaya Hamsa Dasharana. Like that he is moving, and he could have given the cloud a straight way to Alaka, going straight northwards, but he requests the cloud to take a detour. He knows that it will be a Vakrapantha. Vakrapantha yadapi bhavataha prasthitasyottarasham saudhotsanga pranaya vimukho maspabhurujjainyaha. You should not miss the site of Ujjaini. And therefore, even if you have to take a left turn and go towards the west, you should not mind it. Maybe my message to my beloved is delayed for some time. It doesn't matter. But you should go and see the city of Ujjain. Like that, he mentions it. And therefore, it is thought that Ujjain was very important in the life of Kalidasa. He should have spent at least a long part of his life in Ujjaini. And probably you might know that in Ujjaini, even now, Kalidasa Samaroha is held every year. They give such importance to Kalidasa. There is the Vikram University there, because Vikramaditya, and Vikram Urvashi of Kalidasa, all these things are connected. And therefore, Kalidasa had a special love for this city called Ujjain. And when we mention Ujjain, we must go in detail about the description of that special city. Because Kalidasa has described it in such wonderful words that you cannot find such description anywhere else. He says, Vakrapantha yadapi bhavata prasthitasyottarasham saudhotsanga pranaya vimukho masmabhur jainya sheshai punyair hritamiva divah kantimat khandamekam. How did Ujjain come to this world? It is not a part of the earth. There were many people who had earned a lot of merit by performing various types of yajnas, and with that merit they went to Swarga. They enjoyed it for some time, but after they have spent all the merit, all the punya, they have to come back to this world. But they did not want to miss the Swarga, and therefore all of them, Swarginam Gangatanam, when they come back to this earth, they want to have the experience of Swarga, and therefore, with the remaining punya they had, all of them bought a piece of Swarga and brought it and placed on the earth, and that is Ujjain. That type of love Kalidasa had for Ujjain, and this Ujjain was placed in the country called Avanti. Avantishu Ujjayini Nama Nagari. That is how Bhasa, the great dramatist before Kalidasa, described it. Hence, Swapnavasavadatta is centered there. That Ujjayini is also a place there. Because the heroine of that drama, Vasavadatta, she was a daughter of Pradyodha. And Kalidasa says, Prapyavantin Udayana Katha Kovida Grama Vruddhan. You go to any grama, any village there, there will be Vruddhas, old people, who will tell you Udayana Katha Kovida. The stories of Udayana and Vasavadatta, they are told by the elders of every village. When you read the Prapyavantin Udayana Katha Kovida Grama Vruddhan, and he tells that story also because Kalidasa had a very great regard for Bhasa, his predecessor. This Bhasa had written wonderful dramas, and when Kalidasa wrote his first drama, he wonders, who will see my drama? Because there are great dramatists like Bhasa. Bhasa Saumilla Kaviputradinam Prabandhan Atikramya Vartamana Kaveh Kalidasasya. The contemporary Kalidasa. Katham Bhumana. How people have any regard for my drama? Like that he thinks. And therefore, how Bhasa described that place, how those stories were told. Pradyotasya Priyaduhitaram Vatsarajotra Jakre Haimam Talad Dhruvavanam Abhu Atratasyaiva Rajya Nalagirihi Stambham Utpatya Darpat Ityagantrun Ramayati Jano Yatra Bandhun Abhijna. You know the nature of people. When somebody comes to Mysore, we start telling the stories of our kings. Mysore kings. Like that, in Ujjayini, the people are telling Udayana came and took away Vasavadatta from this place, the dear daughter of Pradyotha. Pradyotasya Priyaduhitaram Vatsarajo Atra Jahre. Here was the golden mango grove of that king in this place. And it was here that the big elephant Nalagiri was conquered by Udayana, and on that seating Vasavadatta, he took away her. All these things, all these stories are said by the elders of that place, that Ujjayini, to whichever village you go. Like that he describes. And in Ujjain, the most important god even today is Mahakala. When I went to Ujjain a few years ago to attend the Kalidasa Samaroha, of course I visited Mahakala. And Kalidasa says, O cloud, you might reach Ujjain in the morning, whatever time you might reach, but you should wait there until the evening. It is in the evening that a wonderful worship is performed, that arati, etc., is performed to Mahakala. Apyanyaspin jaladhara Mahakala masajya kale sthatavyante charamagim yavadatyeti bhanuhu. Until the bhanu, the sun, reaches the western mountain, that is, until he sets, you have to wait there. And there, giving your services to Lord Mahakala, you will have the right conclusion of your life. That is sarthakya. See, you will have that happiness of having served the Lord, and therefore you must see the temple, you must see the worship that is being performed in the temple. Like that, are many details that river Shipra. Shipra Vataha Priyatamaiva Prathana Chatukara Dighi Kurvan. Wonderfully he describes how the breeze blows on the Shipra river. Even now you know Ujjaini, that Shipra it is called now. Its correct name is Kshipra. Kshipra means fast, that which flows fast. That Kshipra river, that has become Shipra river now. That Shipra river, how aarti is performed there, how the people congregate, and how the breeze that blows there talks to people. Chatukara. Chatukara is a lover that tries to coax his beloved. Like that, the breeze that is there, that is blowing there, is doing. Like that, all the descriptions, wonderful descriptions about the Ujjain are given by him.
That was a wonderful overview about the city of Ujjain, because he also spent almost 6 verses on Ujjain, and then he gives a very vivid description, and in a very lively manner that you have also described, we can relate to the imagery that Kalidasa is creating, both about that Mahakala as well as the Avantipura Ujjain of that place. And I'm sure that due to time restriction we cannot go on and on, but then I'm sure we can have much larger vivid description about this place. But going ahead in his journey, Kalidasa describes the Kailasha also in greater detail. Can you spend a few minutes on the
Kailasa? Yeah, you see, Kailasa actually comes at the end, you know. Before that, he goes to various places called Devagiri, which Kalidasa says is the place of Skanda, God Skanda. Tatra Skandam Niyata Vasatim Pushpa Meghi Kritatma. See, make yourself a cloud of flowers and shower those flowers on that god Skanda. And then he refers to Brahmavarta, the country called Brahmavarta. Brahmavartam Janapadamatha Chayaya Gahamana. And that Brahmavarta, of course, you have heard the word Aryavarta. And this Brahmavarta was the place that was between the two rivers, Saraswati and Drishadvati. There were two ancient rivers, Saraswati and Drishadvati. Why was that river called Saraswati? Because Saras means ponds, lakes. When that river flowed, on the way, it created various lakes, and that was why it was called Saraswati. Another river was there, parallel to it, and it was called Drishadvati. Drishad in Sanskrit means rocks. It was flowing between the rocks. Rocks were mainly on its course, and therefore it was called Drishadvati. Between these two rivers, the countries that lies, that is situated, is called Brahmavarta. Saraswati Drishadvatyoho Devanadyor Yadantaram Tam Brahma Nirmitam Desham Brahmavartam Prachakshate. It is called Brahmavarta. And therefore, he describes this Brahmavarta, and there Saumya Saraswati Nam Antashuddhah Tvamapi Bhavita Varnamatrena Krishna. O cloud, if you drink the clean waters of Saraswati, then Antashuddhah, inside you will also be white, very clean. But Varnamatrena Krishna, only in your color you will be black, but inside you will be Shuddha. And thus, don't miss to drink the waters of the Saraswati. And then afterwards, he goes to Jahnavi. Janho Kanyam, the most important river of India, that is Janhavi, Janhu's daughter. And that he says, Sagara Tanaya Swarga Sopana Panktim. What is this Saraswati? What is this Ganga River? It is actually the stairs on which the sons of Sagara walked to, climbed up to the heaven. Sagara Tanaya Swarga Sopana Panktim. That is Ganga. See that? And then go to Gangotri. There you will see this Himalaya mountain. There is a wonderful description of the Himalaya mountains. And there the particular mountain called Kailasa. That Kailasa, Kailasasya Tridasha Vanita Darpanasya Atithisya. That Kailasa is like a mirror for the damsels of the divine world. It is so white, so clear that they can look at their faces, keep making it like a mirror. Kailasasya Tridasha Vanita Darpanasya Atithihi Syaha. You become a guest of that Kailasa. And that near that Kailasa, there is this city called Alaka. Alaka is the city where this Yaksha also earlier lived. In the very beginning of the poem, the poet is telling that the destination is Alaka. Gantavyate Vasatir Alaka Nama Yakshesvarana. And how is that described? Bahyodhyana Sthita Harashira Chandrika Dhauta Armya. All the beautiful buildings of that city are made white by the moonlight, because the moon is sitting on the head of Shiva, who lives very nearby. Because this Shiva is supposed to be a great friend of Kubera. Kubera's Trembaka Sakha. That's how the Amarakosha tells about Shiva. And therefore, he is the friend of Kubera. Near the city of Kubera, according to the request of Kubera, he is living there. And on his head is the crescent moon. And the light of that crescent moon, all the 30 days of the month, not only on the full moon day, all the 30 days of the moon, that is making the city of Alaka wonderful. And therefore, there you be a guest in Kailasa and reach Alaka. Natvam drishtva napunar alakam nyasyase kamacharin. If you see that Alaka, immediately you will recognize it as Alaka. No one can miss it. It is such a wonderful city. When you see it, you definitely recognize it as Alaka. And there lives my beloved. So, in the second half of the Meghadhuta, there is the description of that heroine, that Yakshi, how she is waiting for this Yaksha, and how waiting till she is awake, the cloud should convey the message, and what are the words of the message. All these details are given by the Yaksha to the cloud. Of course, Kalidasa is giving it. And so, maybe sometime in the life of Kalidasa, he was separated from his beloved, and he might have thought of sending the message, and through the metaphor of this Yaksha, Yakshi, etc., he might have given. Some other commentators are of the opinion that actually the poet was thinking about Rama and Sita. There are so many allusions to the story of the Ramayana in the Meghadoota. In the very beginning, Janakatanayasnanapum. Village in India, wherever you go, if there is a hill, if there is a body of water, and the people try to connect their village to the story of Rama, Mahabharata, etc. Here Sita bathed, here Rama changed his dresses, like that. Like that, even in Ramagiri, he is saying, Janaka Tanaya Snana Punyoda Keshu. Janaka Tanaya is Sita. She had her bath there, she bathed there, and therefore these waters have become punya. And even when the message has to be conveyed, says, when you try to address her, she looks at you like Sita looked at Hanumanta in the Ashoka. Maithili vonnu kisa. Raghupati padaihi. And these places are, see, in many places we say, in many villages, here there is the footprint of Rama. Like that, Raghupati padaihi ankitam mekhalasu. In this hill, these mekhalas, that is foothills, are marked by the footprints of Rama. So, such an intimate idea of those places, such friendliness with those places, affinity with those places, these mark the descriptions given by Kalidasa. That is why he is Kavi Kulakulu. Anyone that tries to write, there are so many imitations of the Meghadoota. Many poets have written like that. Pavana Duta by Dhoi, Shuka Duta making a parrot the conveyor of the message, Bhringa Duta making a bee the Druta. Like that, there are so many imitations of the Kalidasa. Imitations are imitations. The original is the original. There is no doubt about it. No imitation can beat the original.
That's nice. Is there anything other geographical aspect that you would like to cover that we have missed out, or do you feel this is...
Well, one thing is the Vidisha. Tesham dikshu prathita vidisha lakshanam rajadhani. These words appear in the Meghadoota. Even now, you know, there is a city called Vidisha. Even to the present day. This, how the people of Vidisha are enjoying life, all these things are described by Kalidasa. That is where we can, this Ujjain, Vidisha, etc., where we can connect, we can understand the ancientness of our cities. From the time of Kalidasa, or even earlier at the time of Bhasa, these cities were there. Bana also, in his Kadambari, Vidisha Vidhana Nagari Raja Dhanya Seet. For the King Shudraka, this Vidisha was the Rajadhani, it was the capital city. So, throughout in history, this Vidisha has been a capital city of that place. And so, he had that intimate knowledge of the various places, various cities. And another most important thing is about the river Chambal. Now, for some time it was notorious for the dacoits, etc., this Chambal. But when Kalidasa knew it, it was a holy river. It is called Charmanvati. Charmanvati. There was a great king called Rantideva. Sroto Murtya Bhuvi Parinatam Rantidevasya Kirtim. That is what Kalidasa says. Rantideva's reputation, Rantideva's fame itself has become this beautiful river called Charmanvati. Charmanvati has now changed its name as Chambal. And so this is another geographical place that Kalidasa describes in the Meghadutta.
So, it is indeed very apt to read Kalidasa in his own language, that is Sanskrit. But then given that not many of the youngsters or non-Sanskritists get acclimatized with Sanskrit or with Kalidasa through a translation. And invariably, it happens to be an English translation. Among them, what according to you is the best English translation for Kalidasa in general and particularly for Meghadutam that you suggest?
Yeah, I think some of the Englishmen, see the Britishers who visited this place, they were very much fascinated by the beauty of Kalidasa's works. And they have Rhys Davids, I think, he has translated it in verse. According to English poetic traditions, yes, translated. And of course, later in all languages, in Hindi, in Kannada, in Telugu, in all languages, we have many translations. In Kannada itself, I think we have about 10 translations of the Meghadutta. And it goes on. In every century, according to the language that is used by the people, the new poets want to translate it, and thus they are translating it. And you see, reading a translation, no matter how great a translator is, we cannot expect the Shabda Sangeeta. There is a word which is giving a music. They are musical words. And therefore, some things are not translatable. For instance, in the first stanza of the Meghadutta, Snigdhachaya Tarushu Vasatim Ramagiri Ashrameshu. That is the word that is used. Snigdha means friendly. Chayataru means a particular species of tree called Nameru. It is called Chayataruhu Nameru Syat. That is called Chayataru. But what we see there is the word Chaya, which means shadow, shade. It is in feminine gender. Taru, the word for a tree, is in masculine gender. And so, when that Yaksha lived in the Ramagiri, even the non-living beings, even among them there was Snigdha, there was such a love between the Chaya and the Taru. And so, you can imagine feelings of that Yaksha in such circumstances. However much we try to translate these words, these inner meanings cannot be translated. And so that Shabda Sangeeta is there, and those that are fortunate enough to study some Sanskrit, the early days itself, for our students, we teach the works of Kalidasa, and so at least one sarga of Mrugavamsa or Kumarasambhava, and some stanzas from the Meghadutta are inevitably taught to the students. Those students can appreciate this tenderness of the feelings in Kalidasa. Those, you see, if you want to understand them, a student should sit in front of a teacher, and in every stanza, It may take one full hour to describe the niceties and nuances in one stanza. What are the beauties of the words, special beauties of the words that are used there? And so, like that, Kalidasa can be understood. But we must say, with Mallinatha, the greatest commentator on Kalidasa's works, Kalidasa Giraham Saram, Kalidasa Saraswati Chaturmukho Athava Vetti, Naiva Chanyetu Madrusha. Even Mallinatha says, I cannot understand fully what Kalidasa signifies. And so Kalidasa understood it, Saraswati understood it. Because according to our story, see, in the great lecture hall of Saraswati, poets of all languages were there. And somebody asks a question, who is a kavi? And Saraswati says, Kavirdandi, 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 Nasamsheha. Dandi is the real poet, there is no doubt. And what should be the feeling of Kalidasa at that time? Koham Mataha. Mother, then who am I? Am I not a poet? And Saraswati says, you are not a poet. Tvamevaham, I am you. You are me. Tvamevaham, tvamevaham. And so Saraswati understands it. Maybe Brahma understands it. People like me cannot understand Kalidasa's meanings fully. Like that Mallinatha himself says, what to talk about ordinary people like us.
And slightly unrelated to this, but not related to the Meghadutam, if Mallinatha has got this to say about Kalidasa, then why is it that we normally say, associate Draksha Paka to Kalidasa's work?
Every poetry has many layers of meanings. Chatvariva parimita padani tani vidur brahmanaye manishina. Language has four levels. Manishina. Manasaha isha yeshamastite manishina. Those that have such a concentration, only they can see all those layers. The first layer is very easily available. That is Drakshapaka, no doubt. And that itself is so sweet. And for people like us, that itself is enough. But Guha Trini Nihita Nengayanti Turiyam Vajam Manushya Vadanti. Ordinary people understand only the fourth level, the surface level. But the deeper level, deepest level, etc., they are understood only by very special people. And from that point of view, Kalidasa, Mallinatha is saying that it is not easy to understand Kalidasa.
Yeah, of course it is not easy, but then we have this, we have the luxury of presence of scholars like you who will make us understand Kalidasa. So with that, I express my heartiest dhanyavada and dhanyavada on behalf of Atharva Forum for this beautiful interaction. So, dhanyavada.
Sir, I may not deserve all the nice words that you just now said. However, when one is speaking about Kalidasa, one becomes emotional. And therefore, I might have said some things which might have appeared good to you. And that is on account of your saujanya. Bhavataha hridayasya saujanyam etat na mama gunaha. Tathapi madiyam vandanam samarpayami.
Madiyam api vandanam samarpayami. Dhanyavada.